Ancient eyes. From the infusion room with four recliners turned to western vistas, I finally glimpse this second afternoon of my 64th spring what W.B. Yeats saw clearly from his own twilight mountain, the duo necessary to perfect a work, a life, a soul in lapis lazuli. That triumvirate of workman, noble, and saint who collectively comprise the philosopher's transformational stone. Two ancient Chinamen who willingly climb the mountain of the sublime, accompanied by one like me, a pale serving man. The tower-legged bird of longevity wings overhead, while the Asian pair bidden to play mournful melodies most fitting for the dead, defiantly begin a sprightly tune instead. Yeats. Their eyes, mid many wrinkles, their eyes, their ancient glittering eyes. Their eyes gaze far beyond mere tragedy, it seems, to whence something brighter, dressed in flesh, yet gleams, barks, amusement. But when we take our leave of that sunny room where two Chinamen also recline near me to infuse that afternoon, Joanne finds unbidden on the fast lane home a place of sudden tears. So pulls off to wipe her eyes in a random parking lot, and then, in that unexpected space between our worlds, rapid round the corner come, clip-clop, three horses, three horsemen riding south. They ride, 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 and sigh, pass me by. Prance past even the bow-legged, dark-haired young beauty in tall indigo boots, new black shorts and revealing black top, who, Venus with a crumpled bag of fast food in hand, slowly strides toward Miss Kitty's topless club, focused perhaps upon the prospect of this night's crass G-string cash. She appears unable to dream of demanding greater tribute for divine beauty. Has no eyes to see the impossible shape-shifting one-horned white stallion who stands in the street behind her. That I, a nodding chemo-brained unicorn, have just turned my burnished horn to gape.